praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, most high. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, most high. We worship and adore you. We worship and adore you. You're so wonderful, so wonderful. Oh, Lord, so beautiful, marvelous, the best I've ever seen. Greatest of all creation. Oh Lord my God, you've always been, you're here with me, you'll always be, oh God. Oh Lord Jesus, you are so good to me. Karamasoraba rebienda rabasara bachujabashana nianda radaratisa. Don't we love to praise you? Oh, Lord, to praise you, to give you honor and adore you, Lord. Don't we love to praise you? Don't we love to honor you? Oh, Lord, my God and my King, everything I am, everything I have, everything I'll ever be, comes from you, Lord. My God, you are so wonderful. You are so wonderful. I love you, Lord. So wonderful. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, we thank you, Lord, that we can yield to you simply by asking. Lord, simply by saying yes. Lord, we yield to you. Lord, we seek after you. Lord, we want to hear from you. Lord, we want to know what you're doing, what you're saying. Lord, we thank you that you've given us the way simply by yielding to you, Holy Spirit, and saying yes. By speaking according to your word. By living according to your word. By walking in the Spirit, by giving thanks, by proclaiming goodness and righteousness and faith and glory and the grace of God to do it all. Lord, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 And amen. The Lord's so good. See if we can switch over. Hallelujah. Oh, praise the Lord. You can be seated if you so desire. Thank you, everybody. You guys are awesome. The Lord is so good, and I am so blessed to be here tonight in my abiding place. I was praying, going down the road today, and just thanking the Lord for my abiding place. And I have an abiding place with Him wherever I am, but I specifically have an abiding place here. I was talking to somebody in my office today, telling them how wonderful the Lord was and how great the things He had done. And she said, where do you go to church? I said, I go to the abiding place. She said, I've heard of that. I saw it's the best church in San Diego. Has been for a long time. You should come. The Lord, He is so good. It's a wonderful place to be tonight. It's Wednesday night and I'm in my abiding place. It's where I belong. Why am I here? I'm here because I want to yield to the Holy Ghost. I'm here because I want to hear from the Holy Ghost. I'm here because I want to hear what God has to say. I want to hear His word. But I don't want to do it in my natural mind. I want to do it the way God delivers it. God delivers it in a heavenly manner. He delivers it in a way that offends the mind many times, makes us wonder about things in the natural. But God says, no, don't pay attention to that. It's the things of the Spirit. The things of the Spirit are so wonderful. They're always love. They're always joy. They're always peace. They're always long-suffering and all the other fruits of the Spirit. They're always that. They're never anything other than that. If you're living in something other than that, you're not living in the Spirit. If you're living in frustration and upset and anger and accusation and just
a sense of sin, then you need to repent. You need to get the blood to take it away, and then you can walk in the Spirit. How do you walk in the Spirit? You say, Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. Give me the Holy Spirit. How much is the Lord going to give the Holy Spirit to them that ask Him? Absolutely every time. You go before God, you say, Lord, I need the Holy Spirit. He's not going to give you some other spirit. He's just not going to do that. He's going to give you the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit is going to work within you the things that God has made within you that are all the fruits of the Spirit. So when you walk in the Spirit, there's going to be humility. There's never going to be self-exaltation, ever, ever. Biggest problem we deal with in a rich country like America is pride and self-exaltation. It's what we have. It's because we go and we're successful. I am capable of picking up this chair. I can walk over here, I can pick up the chair, and if picking up the chair is something they'll pay me money for, I can be lauded and praised for my ability to pick up the chair, or whatever the ability that I have is. But it's worth nothing in the kingdom of heaven. It's worth nothing. The Spirit of God has come to teach us a heavenly way. So I'm praying tonight, been praying today, that we're going to deliver the Word of God by the Spirit to you, that you're going to receive it in a heavenly way. And it's going to change what goes on with you. And you're not going to be locked into the mindsets of the flesh, the mindsets of the natural mind that is happens to be enmity with God. I mean, it's a pretty amazing thing when God declares to us that the carnal mind is enmity with God. It cannot agree with Him. Enmity means we cannot agree. There's no way for us to come past the impasse. In fact, there's no way to compromise. If there's one piece of bread and I want it and Michael wants it and we can't agree on some way to get it together, it's only one, it's got to go to one or the other. We're at enmity with one another over this piece of bread, and we're going to fight over it till one of us gets it. Of course, we wouldn't do that, because both of us would be saying, no, brother, you take it. That's what we would be doing. But enmity is when there is no place of compromise. It's important to understand. When you're in enmity, it's no ability to compromise. You can't. There's no way to split the baby in half. It's either all here or all there. So the carnal mind is that enmity with God means that there is no way for God to compromise with the carnal mind. He cannot. It is impossible. They do not go together any more than light and darkness can exist in the same place. They do not. Absolutely, when you turn on the light, the darkness flees. When you turn off the light, the darkness can come back. That's absolute. God says the carnal mind will not compromise nor agree with me. It can't. It's at enmity. So I would rather have God's mind, the mind of the Spirit, the mind of the Word of God, the mind of Christ, all these synonyms for the things of God. That's what I want. I do not want the carnal mind. Carnal mind is not what I desire. So if that's the case, how am I going to have that? Am I capable, able to sit down and study long enough, work hard enough to get the mind of the Spirit? The answer is absolutely not. I can do everything that I want to try to do, and I cannot get the mind of the Spirit in a natural way. Cannot do it. I cannot accomplish that task. It is way too big for me. So what am I supposed to do? I can't accomplish that which I desire. I am struggling. Until I hear the Word of God that tells me it's very simple to receive the mind of the Spirit. All I have to do is call upon the name of the Lord, I'll be saved. All I have to do is ask the Father for the Holy Spirit, and He'll give me the Holy Spirit. It's just simple. It's way too simple for the natural mind to get. It's that easy. This is what we do. This is what we need. How do I get it? I ask. Do I sometimes need to ask more than once? Mainly because I just don't believe enough to receive it. So let's find a situation where that happens. Let's look at John chapter 6. Amen. I did not know where I was going to start, But now I do. Thank you, Lord. This chapter is amazing. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that goes on here. I mean, Jesus is talking about the work of God is to believe on the one he sent. He's talking about, I'm the bread of life. He's talking, there was miracles of loaves and fishes that were multiplied for lots of people. I mean, there's a lot going on, right? But then he gets down to verse 51, 50. Let's do 50. Now I got to go to 48. I am the bread of life, that bread of life. I am. Jesus said, I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness, but they're dead. They died. Manna only went so far. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. Isn't that incredible? Sounds good. I'm the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. That is incredible. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, because they're thinking in their natural mind. They're going, what's their question? How can this man give us his flesh to eat? How is it possible? How does this work? They're struggling. They do not get it. How do you get this? And then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He just doubled down on it. And they're really struggling. He says, who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eats me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers that eat manna and are dead. He that eats of this bread shall live forever. Wow. These things said he in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. So he's at a place like this. Got a people sitting down, and he's talking, and he's teaching them. And many, therefore, of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it? They aren't getting it either. When Jesus knew in himself and his disciples murmured at it, he said to them, does this offend you? Are you offended at this? What and if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? What are you going to do if you see the Son of Man go up into heaven? It is the spirit that quickens. It's the spirit that makes alive. The flesh, it profits nothing. The words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you that do not believe. They believe not. Because he knew somebody didn't believe. Listen to what he says. The words that I speak unto you. He gave us his word. And this word is taught to us by the Holy Spirit. He comes to deliver the word and to teach you. And this word is meat indeed. It's food for your soul. It's food for your spirit. And Jesus was the word. He said, the words that I speak unto you, they're spirit, they are life. You hear his word and you live by his word and you agree with his word and you believe his word. It's very important that we believe. We know that the scripture says, whosoever believes on him shall be saved. We know that Jesus looks at them and says, there were some of you that do not believe. And that's not a good thing. You want to believe. What do you believe? You agree with his word. How do you agree with his word? You agree with his word by immediately hearing it and saying, yes, Lord, this is what I want. Yes, Lord, this is what I want in my life. Yes, Lord, this is how I want to do things. When it comes to you, and he says, you shall not covet, you say, Lord, I don't want to covet. I don't want to do that. Whether you understand all the ramifications of it or not, you're saying, Lord, I want what you want, and I don't want you what you don't want. You begin to agree with his word. And you know what happens? When you agree with his word, and you eat his word, and you read his word, and you speak his word, it brings life to you. It's life in you. It's coming up out of you. It's rivers of living water that come up out of you and begin to go forth and to spread the life of God all around. This is what Jesus does. He puts life in you that life may come out of you and that the Spirit of God may flow from you and bring life to those around you so that everything it touches is made alive. The rivers of God, they go and everything they touch is made alive. That's what the rivers of God do. So he's sitting here and he's telling them, you got to eat my flesh, you got to drink my blood. And because they did not know who he was and they did not believe who he said that he was, they could not receive it. They just couldn't receive it. They thought he was talking about cutting his arm off and cooking it or something. They did not know how to receive it because they did not believe who he was. That's simply the problem. We think, oh, well, you know, it's natural mistake. They just were, you know, confused because it hadn't been explained well. That's not true. And they didn't receive it because they couldn't hear it because they did not believe who he was. Because let's read what comes next. Verse 65, he said, therefore said I unto you, no man can come to me except it were given unto him and my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and they walked no more with him. That's pretty incredible. Then said Jesus to the 12, are you going to go away too? He looked right at him. And Simon Peter said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that you are that Christ, the Son of the living God. Listen to his testimony. He didn't maybe understand what Jesus was talking about. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. He may not have been able to expound upon that scripture. But he certainly knew what he believed. Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered, have not I chosen you and one of you as a devil? He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12, the same one that he said did not believe. The first thing, he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. You have to believe he is. You have to know there's a God in heaven. You have to know that there's a Jesus who came to earth and died for you. You have to hear it, you have to believe it, and then you act upon it. And this word is life to you. It's true. The Spirit quickens. The Spirit makes alive. The flesh, it doesn't profit anything. Nothing. All the money, all the fame, all the bigger house, bigger car, nicer and fancier clothes, whatever it is that you want, fancy restaurant with bigger food, whatever. None of it profits anything. No profit. But the Word of God, it gives you life. Is life profitable? Life is the best thing you could ever get. Amen. Life is good. Life is wonderful. Life is fun. Life is life. It's so good. This is what we desire. Well, how are we going to have it? We have got to get out of our natural mind and into the mind of the Spirit. We have to do it God's way, and it doesn't require any effort on your part other than to say yes. This is what we have to get. This is what has been shouted, yelled, every other way you could deliver the Word of God, telling people, get out of you and into Jesus. Stop relying upon you, rely upon Jesus. Stop talking about you, talk about Jesus. Stop thinking about how it affects you, start thinking about Jesus. One of the scripture Paul wrote said that you should not look on the things of yourself, look on the things of somebody else. Why? Because you got a river of life flowing out of you, and when I see my brother and my sister have need, I can begin to speak the word. It may be praying in tongues. It may be praying by prophecy. It may be praying in the Spirit. I may not even talk to them, but I'm going before God, and I see a need. My brother has a need. My sister has a need. I begin to say, Father, bless them. Take care of the need. Lord, I thank you that you do it. He may use you to do it. He may use somebody else, but I tell you, when you're speaking life out of your spirit, it's making a difference. Hallelujah. This begins where we begin to understand how it is that we walk in the Spirit. I want to walk in the Spirit. I've tried many things to help myself to walk in the Spirit more. Most of them don't amount to much because they're relying upon the natural ability. well, if I just do this and if I just do that, I'll be able to walk in the Spirit better. What I found is the way you walk in the Spirit is you ask. You simply ask. Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. Lord, I need to walk in the Spirit more. Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit with you. Lord, I want to do it your way. Lord, I want the fullness of the Holy Ghost flowing out of me. It just starts to grow. It begins to be your prayer. It begins to be your desire. It begins to be all you can think about. And you're just saying, Lord, I just want to flow with you. And you know what happens? Without any ability of your own, it begins to work in you. It's a river. You don't control rivers. You don't control them. You let them flow. You could dam them up, I guess. But eventually, it's going to fill up behind the dam. It's going to run right over the top of the thing. Let the river flow. How do I let the river flow? What's the first thing I learned to do? I give thanks. Lord, thank you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving me life. Lord, I thank you for redeeming me. Lord, I thank you for freeing me from sin. Lord, I thank you for putting me in the abiding place. Lord, I thank you for all the people you've set around me. Lord, I thank you for loving me with all the love there is in heaven, all the love that could possibly be on earth you've loved me with. Lord, I thank you for all of these things. Thanksgiving just becomes something that rolls out of you. What are you doing when you're giving thanks? Walking in the Spirit. Because it's what God told us to do. So when you walk in the Spirit, what happens? You don't fulfill the strong desire of the flesh. What happens with the strong desire of the flesh? It leads you into a natural mind. You begin to think about how you're going to accomplish in your natural mind. And guess what? You end up finding yourself at enmity with the ways of God. You can't compromise with them. So then you're always at a point of choosing. You know what's a really blessing, a big blessing around here? Is when you're at one of those points where you found yourself having to choose. You walk into a place like this. Pastor preaches the word. By the Spirit, you know what it does? It brings a sword, divides asunder everything, and shows you exactly what choice you should make. Now, you still get to choose. You can decide to stay the way you are, or you can decide to receive the change. You get to choose that. It's your decision. God didn't take that away from you. But you're given the opportunity to see it clearly by the Word of God and to make a decision to choose God's way or your own way, even if you don't really understand. Maybe you just know that you heard the word of God and it told you to do something and you said, okay, I'm going to do that. I'm going to give thanks. And you don't understand Thanksgiving. You don't understand exactly what you're supposed to be thankful for. But you begin with, Lord, I thank you that you're helping me to understand. It's that simple. I'm going to be obedient. I'm going to give thanks. And you do it and it begins to work something in you. It works in you the power of God to set you free from a natural mind so that you can walk in the Spirit and be a blessing to everybody around you. Hallelujah. That's what it does. This is what we desire. It's what we want to do. Let's look at Romans chapter 8. We're going to read the scripture on the enmity part. We're going to look at a couple other things. Romans chapter 8. We all know it so well, I hope. We've heard it preached many times, sometimes very extensively. And, Lord, we thank you. Chapter 8, let's start at the beginning. There is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who don't walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Isn't that amazing? No condemnation. You can live without a sense of sin, without a sense of feeling separated from God, without a sense of being divided. You can live that way. All you have to do is walk in the Spirit, not after the flesh. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. His Spirit of life set me free from the bondage of sin. It's another way to say it. This is what he did. He set me free. I'm so glad Jesus set me free. Right? I'm so glad Jesus set me free. I'm so glad Jesus set me free. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus set me free. It's a great one to know. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak because it relied upon your ability, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. He showed you didn't need to walk in sin in this life. He made it very clear. Jesus went to the cross, no sin. Devil had nothing in him, nothing, none. And he's given us the walk in the Spirit so we can walk the same way he walked. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally, naturally, fleshly minded is death. Ouch. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, and neither indeed can it be. It's not possible. So why you hear God in the Old Testament saying, oh, that there were a heart in them to keep my word. Isn't that amazing? He's crying out for it. Did he give us one? Yes. Ezekiel declared it was coming. I'm going to make a covenant in those days and put my law within their hearts, in their minds. I'm going to write them. Isn't that amazing? This is great stuff. I just love this stuff. Talk about this stuff all day. Let's look in Galatians. It's another scripture in Galatians. A couple of them that are really good on this subject, I find. Chapter 2 of Galatians, verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet it's not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That's a lot to give thanks for. I mean, thank you, Jesus, for everything you did. I remember when I first came to Christ, I used to go, Lord, I can't believe that you went to the cross. I mean, I started looking at what crucifixion was all about, and I thought, Lord, no, that's just horrendous. I just sort of focused on that just for a while. Just was so amazed that he would go through such horrible torture for me. Then I began to understand, he didn't just go through that. There was so much more he went through I don't have time to get into. I mean, he got chastised, he got rebuked, he got mistreated, he got lied about. I mean, everything you've ever thought anybody ever did bad to you, he got it way beyond what you've ever gotten it. And all those things happened to him, and he laid down his life completely for me. He did that for me. So that now I could be crucified with him. The nails kind of freak me out. I don't know if I want the nail thing. I sympathize with Peter when Jesus told him what was going to happen to him, and Peter understood that he was going to go be crucified as well when he was old. I kind of sympathize with Peter. But what about him? You know, that seems like a lot. But you know, God never asks us to do or go through something that he doesn't give us the grace to do. We think all the time about something like that. He gives us grace. By faith, we can do anything, anything. And he gives us the grace to do it. So you never have to worry. We'll get to that later, I think. So, in 2:20, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Then we flip over to chapter 5 of Galatians. And we see some amazing things. Oh, Lord. Father. How do you break in? Let's go to verse 5:5. For we, through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Pastor Mark translates this word expectation because we have this modern idea of hope that isn't the hope of 1611, okay? In 1611, hope meant basically expectations. It's what when you hope for something, you had great expectation it was gonna pass. It wasn't, oh, I hope it happens. It was, I hope to have this very shortly. You know, that was the way it was. So today, since hope has been so watered down, we talk about this in terms of expectations. But We wait for the expectation of righteousness by faith. There is a full expectation of the righteousness of God to come when you believe, when you act in faith. For in Christ Jesus, in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision avails anything, nor uncircumcision. What is that? That's a carnal thing. It's a fleshly thing. It's something that marks somebody in their flesh, but it has nothing to do with the Spirit. But it's faith which works by love. This is what we have here. It's not carnal things, it's faith, and it works by love, by the Spirit. Verse 7, you did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? This persuasion doesn't come of him that calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Remember I said there's no compromise between the mind of the Spirit and the mind of the flesh? There's no compromise. It's not compromisable. You can't sit down with God and say, let us reason together and come up with a compromise on it. There isn't one. It doesn't allow itself to be compromised. And a little leaven, a little bit of natural mindedness, leavens the whole thing. A little bit of sin leavens the whole thing. The whole thing. It's ruined. You can't have unleavened bread and put just a little bit of leaven in it, because it'll leaven the whole thing. Does everybody realize that leaven multiplies itself? You know why? Because it's a living thing. People don't realize what leaven is, but it's yeast. Yeast grow, they multiply, they have babies, and then the babies have babies, and they do it very, very quickly. If you put a little bit of leaven in a lump of bread, it's gonna get to the whole thing. The whole thing's gonna get full of leaven. Leave it there long enough, the whole thing's gonna get leaven and grow. Sin is like that. It is going to multiply itself. It's going to grow. It's going to destroy. God has spent all of these thousands of years proving very clearly that you cannot live forever in sin, that sin brings death. The smallest sin, the smallest bit of sin. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. A little carnal mind puts you at enmity with the Spirit of God. You can't have any. Verse 10, I have confidence in you through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubles you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. Somebody's teaching them something wrong. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross cease. I'm off where I wanted to be. I'm almost there. I would that you were cut off, even they were cut off, even which trouble you, for brethren. Here's where we want to be. Brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. We have this incredible responsibility before God to love one another. First song, big song, I've talked about it here many times, that we used to sing at the Abiding Place was love one another, even as I have loved you. I love that song. Been singing it for 30 some years. Just love one another, for I have loved you. This is what we're called to do. Well, how do you love? You love by the Spirit. So this scripture right here says you've been called to liberty. But don't use liberty as an occasion to the carnal mind, to the flesh, to sin. Don't. He's commanding you, don't. Many people take liberty that they've been called into, they've been set free to do whatsoever God called them to do, and they think they're going to take that liberty, and that liberty means I can now go and sin with impunity. It's just a lie. What was happening here is that they were being told, the Gentiles were being told, that if they wanted to enter in the covenant, they needed to get circumcised. That's nowhere near as bad, in my mind, as telling people it's okay to sin and they can still walk with God. That's pretty bad. Paul's upset because they're getting into anything natural that's going to bring salvation. Everything that God wants to bring to you, he brings by the Spirit. It's not by your ability. It's not by the flesh. It's not by your natural mind. It's not by what you can figure out. It's not by how good you are at doing anything. It isn't about that. It's about you choosing to believe God and to walk in the Spirit. This is what you want to choose to do. You don't want to choose to walk in your natural mind in anything. So going out and getting circumcised because you think God's going to accept you better is a very bad idea. You do not want to do that. Or anything else that you're going to do in the flesh that's going to make you acceptable to God. If I go to church three times a day, every day of the week, does that make me more acceptable with God? No. It would be good for me. But it doesn't make me more acceptable. How am I made acceptable? By what have I received righteousness? By Jesus Christ. This liberty that I've received is not an occasion to the flesh, but it's by love to serve one another. So guess what comes out of that? We know people and we see people all the time that we've loved, that we've cared about, that we've ministered to, and they're making really dumb choices. They're making bad choices. You know they're bad choices. You understand they're bad choices. But when you go to them and try to talk to them, they don't want to hear what you have to say. So how are you going to help them? By your natural mind? Maybe if we sit down, write a book, they'll understand. Maybe if we could just take them out to dinner and feed them something good and tell them how much we love them, they would listen. But it doesn't work. Sometimes with all the pleading you've got, you're telling somebody, please, don't you understand what you're doing to yourself? They don't get it. Why? Because they're never going to get it that way. How are they going to get it? By love, serve one another. When you love people, even when they're really bad to you, when you love people, even when the things they do cause you to just get, it's like the worst smell you ever smelled. It just, you can't stand it. You want to leave the room. It's so just foul. People acted in ways that are so bad. But you love them anyway. You love them through it. And by the Spirit, you begin to minister the Word of God to them. They then can be broken out of whatever it is that's holding them in bondage that doesn't allow them to see. All the pleading, all the classes, all the Bible studies, all of the arguments in the world will get you nowhere. Get you nowhere. But when you, by love, serve one another, you can get a lot of places that are good. And that love comes by the Spirit. This is how we need to live. Every one of you can think of situations you're going through right now, dealing with people, where they've either mistreated you or you've mistreated them, or they have done something you know is wrong, and you tried to explain it to them and they didn't get it, where you've tried to be nice to people and they have turned your nice right back at you, or you have been angry at somebody for something that they didn't mean, or whatever. You can think of issues like that. What are we supposed to do? We're supposed to walk in the Spirit. Well, how am I supposed to walk in the Spirit? I ask, Lord Jesus, help me. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you saved me. I thank you for the blood that washes me from all sin. Lord, forgive me for everything I've done wrong. Now, Holy Spirit, I ask you, Father, send me the Holy Spirit. If I can't feel him at all, Lord, send him to me. Holy Spirit, thankfully for me, it's usually, Holy Spirit, come up out of me. Come flowing out of me. Begin to move by the Spirit and see the problem change. It may take a while. It might take a long time. I've seen people, they receive the Word of God and then they just go off the rails and they disappear. And you pray for them and plead for them and you minister to them, and then they can come back and get right back on where they're supposed to be, because God will do that. But by love, you never stopped loving them. Not by your own ability, but by the Spirit. Somebody mistreats you, you keep loving them. Somebody says all manner of evil against you falsely, you keep loving them. Because it isn't about how you appear to other people. It's not about your reputation. It's not about anything of the natural. It's about the Spirit. This is how we want to walk. So how again do I walk in the Spirit? I ask for the Holy Spirit. Then I obey the Word of God and begin to do what he commanded to do. He commanded me to give thanks. He commanded me to praise. He commanded me to yield myself to the Spirit of God working within me, that rivers might flow out of me. Ask him for a drink, and the rivers will flow out of me. This is all he asks us to do. So that in every one of those situations where there's a problem, where there's a difficulty with people, whoever they may be, we have a very simple answer. Walk in the Spirit. This is where we wanted to get. This is what's been on my heart all day, is people who struggling because their mind and the people around them, just like Paul talks about here when he says, I really am upset with the people that trouble you. I'm upset with them that lie to you and tell you things that aren't true, or convincing you that the only way God's going to accept you is if you get circumcised. And he's telling them this is wrong. You go in that direction just a little bit and the whole thing is leavened. The whole thing. But he tells us that what we're called to is by love to serve one another. So he's telling us the way out of all of that stuff is to stop. You know, Jesus told us, do not judge. And it's, you know, every secular person's favorite scripture. Don't judge. Well, Jesus wasn't kidding when he said not to judge, but what was he talking about? He's talking about, it's not my job to convince you of sin. It's not my job to condemn you. It's not my job to correct you even necessarily. It's my job to flow in the Holy Ghost. When I flow in the Holy Ghost and by love I serve you, guess what happens? Holy Ghost does his job. He has the job of convincing you of sin. So that you what? Will be feeling bad about yourself and miserable and crawl on the floor so we can all laugh at you. No. He wants you to be convinced of sin so you'll do one very simple thing. The first message Jesus began to preach, the first message John the Baptist began to preach was repent. It's the most powerful word, repent. Just say, I don't want that. I want God's way. That's all you have to say. It's that simple. Lord, I renounce the things of sin. Lord, I want things of your way. It's that easy. It's just as easy as walking in the Spirit. Lord, I want to walk in the Spirit. I don't want to walk in my natural mind. He'll teach you. He'll show you. He'll bring you along. Just choose to do it. It helps if you choose to do it every day. Helps if you choose to do it multiple times a day. Just keep on doing it until it becomes who you are. He made you that person inside. He wants you to walk as a Jesus revealing person all the time. And that by love we would serve one another, so that we would stop judging people with comparisons of our natural mind. That's what he told us not to do. I see somebody who's lost in sin, I don't sit around going, I can't believe how stupid people can be. I don't need to do that. What I need to do is begin to say, oh, Father, I thank you for the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come flow through me and make a difference. Whether it's just praying, whether it's ministering to them, whether it's laying hands on them, whether it's bringing them to church, whatever it might be, Holy Spirit, make a difference in that life. Holy Spirit, bring something to them. So yeah, I recognize that what they did was wrong. I can judge. I got enough discernment to figure that out. But my goal is not to condemn them. My goal is not to beat them up. My goal is to serve them. We want to serve one another. Just by love, serve one another. Somebody does something you don't like, serve them. Love them. Pray for them. Do everything you can to show them how much you care, how much you love them. They mistreat you, they take your coat, give them your cloak also. Whatever it might be. This is what we're called to do. We want to walk in the Spirit, this is what we do. Don't go, but he didn't, she didn't. How come I'm supposed to walk in the Spirit and that one was so mean to me when they're supposed to be so holy? We just missed it. You missed it completely. You will not rise or stand in comparison to anybody else here in this room or any place else on the earth. You will not. You will rise or stand by one standard, the standard of God. That's the standard. It's the Jesus standard. In Jesus' standard, there's no sin. There's the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus that you have received freely from him. That is what the standard is. You better have the righteousness of God or you're not standing. It's that simple. In fact, he better know you. Because if he doesn't know you, and you come before him and tell him, but didn't I do all these great things? I was better than most. I was better than many people I knew. In fact, in compared to everybody I knew at the Abiding Place, I was the best of them all. I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. Because just a little leaven, guess what it does? Leaven's the whole lump. So what do I do if I discover that there's iniquity? I've done something that's wrong. What do? I repent. Well, how am I going to know that there's iniquity if I don't know? I'm going to walk in the Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit, he's going to convince me of sin. He's going to show me where I messed up. You know, if I'm in a situation and somebody is mistreating me and I get angry and I start calling them every name in the book and telling them about it, it isn't going to be long till the Holy Ghost is going to be going, hello, you're not doing what you're supposed to do. Because I spend my time walking in the Spirit, it's going to be even stronger. Now, if I don't walk in the Spirit, if I'm used to not walking in the Spirit, I'm used to walking in my natural mind all the time, it may take a while for the Holy Spirit to get my attention. Because I'm not used to hearing his voice. Because it's not in the fire, and it's not in the storm, and it's not in the earthquake. It's still small voice. It says, don't do that. That's the wrong thing to do. Oh, Lord, forgive me. I'm so sorry. That's so wrong. Forgive me. I shouldn't have done that. Lord, thank you for telling me. Forgive me. Wash me clean in the blood. Let me walk in the Spirit from this moment forward. That's all it takes. It's all it takes. It's that simple. Can we get that? Can we, for many of us, finally get that? So that we would choose to walk in the Spirit and not be sitting around judging ourselves superior or inferior to anybody else. Now, it says, judge everybody better than yourself. But what I meant by inferior is, I'm not going to walk around condemning myself because I'm just not as good as everybody else. Jesus loved me as much as he loved you. But he loved you as much as he loved me. And he told me not to concentrate on me, but to concentrate on loving you, not how much you love me. You have to worry about how much you love me. That's your job. My job is to love you. That's it. Simple. But we get all wrapped up in how much I'm loved by this one, or how much I'm accepted, and nobody listens to me, and nobody pays attention to me, and all the things of condemnation. There's no condemnation when you walk in the Spirit. Holy Ghost. There's another aspect to walk in the Spirit. Very, very, very important aspect that we must have. There are the fruits of the Holy Ghost. We've been talking about that. But there's also the flow and the gifts of the Holy Ghost. And you really can't live in the one without the other. You can't. Maybe a little. Maybe. But you really can't. There has to be the flow of the Holy Ghost. Well, how do I flow in the Holy Ghost? The first thing I learned to do to flow in the Holy Ghost is when I come in here, I do whatever the leader's doing. That's easy. Just do what they're doing. We're up there singing. I sing. Somebody says, raise your hands. I raise my hands. Is it hard? It's not hard. What am I doing? I'm just saying, Holy Spirit, I want to do whatever you're doing. I'm not sure what you're doing. The leader better know what you're doing. So I'm going to follow the leader. It's that easy. What am I doing when I do that? I'm agreeing with God. When I agree with God, I'm being obedient. When I'm being obedient, the Holy Ghost is flowing through me in obedience. And then I begin to do more. Now I begin to sing the song. It begins to mean something deeper to me. It begins to flow out of me with emotions that I hadn't really experienced before. Now the song becomes something really powerful. And I remember it, like, love one another even as I've loved you for 30 years. And you remember it because you walked into a room, somebody's singing the song, and you got so impacted by it, you haven't been able to forget it. For 30 years. These kind of things will happen to you. And then you'll begin to say, well, I want to walk like that. I want to live like this. I like this. I want more of this. And so then you begin to read the word. The word begins to be preached to you, and you begin to agree with it and be obedient to it. And guess what happens? It gets stronger. And it gets stronger. It gets stronger. But here's the thing that happens. Just like in Galatians, where they were fixated on this need. They had false teachers that came to them and said, all of you that want to be in the covenant got to get circumcised. That's what they taught them. Because, you know, God, after all, had said you can't be part of the Jewish covenant if you're not circumcised. So they said you can't be a part if you're not circumcised. They were wrong. They were liars, deceivers. But these people were being greatly affected by this. They needed to get back to their Jewish roots or something. You know, something had to happen. God said, no, it's not what you need to do. In the same way, people come today and they take people who believed on Christ Jesus, they've received salvation, and they come to them and say, the gifts of the Holy Ghost is something you want to avoid. You know, those people that speak in tongues, avoid them. Bad, evil stuff. Shouldn't do that. It's not controllable by men. I'm thinking, that's a good thing. But this is what happens. They teach people not to flow in the gifts of the Holy Ghost, because what they will tell you, their fundamental reason is this: that man cannot control what's true and what's not. You know, they might claim they're prophesying when they're not. They might claim that they have a word of knowledge when they don't. They might claim all sorts of things. And these are the lies that are told to undermine the fact that when you ask for the Holy Spirit, guess what you get? The Holy Spirit is what you get. I vividly remember, I mean, like it happened yesterday, going with my friend Rob White 30 some years ago to a meeting where there were people flowing in the gifts of the Spirit, which we really didn't know much about. I had read in the Bible that such a thing existed, and I'd never seen it, and I was seeking for it. So we went to this meeting, and I got kind of freaked out by some of the things that went on, because it was just contrary to what I knew. And there was another guy with us that said, I'm leaving and there's not enough cars. Somebody has to come with me. Will you come with me? So I left. I left. Bad decision. I left. Rob goes up to get prayed for, and he had heard from somebody else how he needed to stay with the Holy Ghost people. Now, he never told anybody that, but this was something that they talked about. This guy gets up and begins to pray for him and says, you need to stay with the Holy Ghost people. Rob gets so impacted, just so blasted by it. He's telling me all about the next day, and I'm hitting myself with a stick. I'm an idiot. You know, it's kind of whatever. So the next night we go back, and some other guy's preaching, and it, you know, the story goes on. But it was at that point that I began to understand there was a flow of the Holy Ghost where God would say things that nobody knew that that's what you needed to hear. They didn't understand. And, you know, there are things that are said to other people I don't understand, because I don't know what they're going through. But God does. And here's what, I was talking to Pastor Geneva today, because her grandbaby was born.
Yeah.
And so, which is where she is, dealing with that. But I was talking to her today, and she was talking about how many people came to her after she had this really difficult night she ministered here. And all these people coming to her, that was just what I needed to hear. It was the best thing I ever heard. People telling her all these things. And she's thinking, that was the hardest I ever preached. I felt like I got beat up by the powers of darkness. It was so bad. But it was what certain people needed to hear. It wasn't even what she planned on talking about. So we were talking about this because it's really about what the Holy Ghost does. And every single one of you is being ministered to by the Holy Ghost as much as you're willing or able to receive. As long as I'm willing to speak the word of God, as long as I'm willing to say, Lord, I yield to you, as long as I'm willing to say, none of me and all of you, God's going to flow through me by the word of God, by the Spirit of God, and it's going to go to you. And then you have an opportunity to receive it. What prevents you from receiving it? Stiff-necked, hard-hearted, sin, evil words, wrong teaching, things that are in your head that you just cannot receive what the Spirit of God very clearly says, they'll prevent you. So how do you overcome that? Because a lot of times we don't even realize it's that way. You know what overcomes it? Being in the meeting, being in the presence of God. It overcomes it. I mean, you may notice, maybe you don't notice, but we're pretty much here every time. If we're not here, there's a very, very good reason. And I can't get away because my wife will whip out the computer and say, we're watching the service. And she'll turn on the stream. Because we're not going to miss a single service, even when we're hundreds of miles away, as much as it's possible to do. Why? Because I just earned something with God. I got extra brownie points. Ha ha, I made more services this week than you did, so I'm better than you. No. Because being in the presence of God teaches you how to walk in the presence of God. It is something good. That's why you need to be reading the Bible every day. Every day. That's why you need to be in prayer every day. Why? Because you're earning something with God. No. Because you need it. You need it. It's good for you. It's what you need to do. So, let's keep reading because this is really where we're going to be. By love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Look to the things of somebody else, not to things of yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you don't be consumed of one another. That's like the ultimate ouch. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. Remember, they're at enmity with one another. And these are contrary the one to the other. Same thing. So that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. And then he goes on to give some more teaching on the difference between the works of the flesh and the works of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit, which is wonderful. This is what God has called us to love one another. He's called us to love one another, to lay down our lives one for another, just to look at people and tell them, I love you. I look at Joseph all the time. I've known Joseph a long time. Joseph, I love you. That's my friend. I love him. God put that love in my heart years ago, and he never took it away. All I have to do is agree with it. I just have to yield to it. Let's turn to something else. Let's look at Philippians chapter 3. Oh, Lord Jesus, we love you so much. You know, the hardest part doing this is that you want to spend so much time in so many places. I could be here for hours. Just hours. You just dig into stuff. It's in every book. What we're talking about is in every book of the New Testament, every single one. And it's in most of the Old Testament ones. Maybe it's in all of them. But it's talking about how you walk in the Spirit. God has told us many times there is a difference. There is the life that is in God, and then there is the death that is in the world. He's made this very, very clear over and over. So in Philippians 3, verse 17, brethren, be followers together of me and mark them that walk so. This is why it's hard to break in. What is so? It's just people that are walking in their own way instead of the way of God. And you have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping. Now that's pretty intense. Why is he weeping? Because he loves the people that are messed up, and he loves the people he's trying to protect from the people that are messed up. And he's just weeping. He's so overwhelmed with this. I tell you, they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their fleshly lust, their belly, and whose glory is in their shame. They glory in their shame. You know what that means? What's the one thing to be ashamed of? Sin. They glory in their sin. They stand up and talk about how wonderful it is that God accepts them even though they're in their sin. It's horrible. And they mind earthly things. They have a carnal mind. They look at earthly things and they judge by earthly judgments and they measure by things that they can do. For our conversation, people, it's in heaven. That's our manner of living. It's in heaven. From whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body that may be fashioned like unto his glorious body according to the work whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. That's the final end. We've talked a lot about here in recent months, year. Pastor Mark's preached a lot on Revelation and talked a bit about 7th and 8th Kingdom book that he's been working on. And they just got on YouTube almost a year ago now. We did a Daniel study here, 3 hours of Daniel. Did the whole book in 3 hours, whole thing. I call it mandatory watching if you want to understand the last days. I think it's mandatory. I think you should all watch it. It is fantastic. The whole point is we've been talking about something that's to come. Why? Because one of the cardinal doctrines of understanding this is there's going to be eternal judgment. We talked about us not judging people, measuring by our own natural abilities, but there's going to come a judgment of God that's absolutely true. And the wrath of God is going to come upon sin. So when you're glorying in your shame, that's not a good place to be. That's bad. Okay? This is what happens. This is the kind of people that trouble the people of God. They teach them carnally minded assessments of what things ought to be. And they judge by their natural minds, and in that judgment, they teach people to resist the gifts of the Holy Ghost. I will tell you that there is nothing more impactful than when the Spirit of God is moving and the Word of God comes out and it touches your heart right where you needed to be touched. I can remember most recently, James Levesque was here and he preached a sermon that cut me so deep. I had never heard this sermon before. I'd never heard it like that. He talked about Elijah going to pray because he's going to bring rain, right? And he tells his servant to go look. And by the time, you know, he's got to the fifth or sixth time, the servant's going, how many times you make me run up the mountain and look? I'm getting a little tired of this. And the way he preaches, the Holy Ghost came, just cut me to bits. So bad. I mean, just tore my heart wide open. And I saw all these places where I was holding on and harboring judgments of my own against situations, frustrated, like how many times do I have to go up the mountain already? I could hear myself saying that. I was like, oh my God, I'm such a mess. So I was the first person out the seat and in the altar. I was number one off the mark because I had been just messed up. And that's what God will do. You're in need, you're in the meeting, you're asking God to flow in your life, you want the things of God, and He'll come with you. He'll come every way He can possibly get to you to do what? To convince you of your need so that you'll come to Him and you'll ask and He'll take care of it. He does all the work, but it requires your agreement. You have to repent. You have to say yes to the Lord and no to sin. This is how you walk in the Spirit. It's so easy to do. But we make it so difficult because our world, our society, even the church teaches us things that are wrong. And one of the things they teach us is don't flow in the gifts of the Holy Ghost. Most wonderful thing in the world is to pray in the Holy Ghost in tongues and then suddenly up roaring out of your belly is words that you can understand and here you're hearing things you never heard before. And you're going, that is marvelous. And you recognize very clearly it had nothing to do with you. It wasn't your great insight. It wasn't because you were so smart. It wasn't because you'd studied so hard. It wasn't because you could take a test. It was because you had yielded yourself to the Holy Ghost and up out of your belly came rivers of God. These rivers of love, these rivers of joy, these rivers of peace. Oftentimes, that's where the first thing you learn is, Lord, I need some peace. Lord, fill me with your peace. That's good prayer. It's wonderful. He'll do it. Now you begin to say, Lord, I see that need. Father, bless them. You begin to pray for people. You begin to love them. You begin to serve them. You begin to cry out to God for them. And you know what's going to happen is it's going to get stronger in you, and then pretty soon you're going to be able to go to them in love and say just the thing that they need to set them free. You're going to be able to stand in front of a people and speak a word, and it's going to touch their hearts, and it's going to open up a place where they can be set free from whatever's bothering them, whatever it might be. And we get all twisty turned around trying to figure out, you know, how does that happen and how does a Christian get messed up like that? Well, look, I've been walking with God a long time, but there you can hide things in your heart where you hold on to bitterness and you don't realize that's what you're doing. Or you think you've got control of it because you're tamping it down. You're pushing it into its own little spot and you're not allowing it to show itself. So you've got control of it. But what will happen is it'll come bursting itself out right at the most inopportune time. And God says, no, I got to deal with that. But you can't see it because you've got control of it. And then the Holy Ghost comes and says, no, you really don't. You just think you do. You think you have control. You've been excusing the times it sneaks out, making excuses for why. It's always somebody else's fault. And then the Lord comes and puts his finger on it and says, get rid of that right now. Take it away. And all you have to do is repent. All you have to do is repent. And then you can, again, by love, serve one another. Which if you remember nothing else, remember no other scripture tonight, remember that. By love, serve one another. But remember that to walk in the Spirit requires some very simple things. You have to ask. You just ask God. Number two, you have to agree with the Word of God. That's all. Just be willing to agree. Be willing to be corrected. Because God's got to correct you. He's got to show you how to do this. But let the Word of God correct you. It'll correct you. It's a good corrector. It's a wonderful corrector. And you got to be willing to let the Holy Ghost do all the things He wants to do. And so we know He does love, and we know He does joy, and we know He does peace. We also know He does tongues, and we also know He does interpretation of tongues, and He does words of wisdom, and He does words of knowledge, and He does faith, and He does gifts of miracles and healings and all kinds of things He does. He does all of those. You got to be willing to say, Lord, I want those to flow through me too. And so, you know, I've gotten in the habit of when I see little kids, it's like every single one of them, I lay my hands on them, they must recover. So the Lord said that. I lay my hands on them, they recover. And I just begin to, I'm not judging it by any other natural means. I just being obedient to what God told me. You must recover. You must recover. You must recover. Sometimes I preach, sometimes I don't. Sometimes I say more than that, sometimes I don't. But it's in me, I'm saying, Lord, I want this to be so real in me that the gifts of healing that come from the Holy Ghost begin to be manifested in a greater way than we've ever imagined seeing. And so I'm going to start with agreeing with your word. Lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Amen. The Lord, they're going to recover. Got to recover. Got to recover. Absolutely, got to recover. Just doing it every single time. Without fail. Because what am I doing? I'm agreeing with God. I'm just agreeing with Him. I'm not judging it. I'm not trying to figure out how it works. I'm not trying to say, look at me, I've figured this out. I haven't figured anything out. I'm just agreeing with God. It's that simple. When you agree with God, you're going to have the results of God. Because God's results are true. They're always right. He never fails. He can do anything. Anything. There is nothing that He can't do. He can do it all. And He's given us the opportunity. You know, when you look at what God has done, you just go through the Bible and you look at all the things that He did, opening up His arms and crying out to His people and saying, return to me. Just return to me. Just come to me. Just repent. Just choose to not go that way and come over here. Just believe me. Put your trust in me. I'll take care of it. I'll do it all. Just come and agree with me. Just come and do what I tell you to do. This is simple. As He said, we have an advocate with the Father. If any man sin, we have an advocate. Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is my advocate. And He goes and He'll take care of all the sin. All I have to do is say, Lord, forgive me. Wash me in the blood. Done. He'll take care of it. Very simple. God wants us just to agree with Him. And that's how we have to walk in the Spirit. But there's a place here. There's no place, none, for pride. There's no place for self-exaltation. None. You cannot exalt yourself in this place. The moment you begin to judge yourself to be superior in any way to anybody else, you missed it. You missed it. You can't flow anymore. It doesn't happen. You, by love, serve one another. You serve people. When you know, if you're ever up here and you're ministering in this place, I'm going to tell you right now, there is an intense mandate. You serve the people. It had nothing to do with me up here. It had none. to do with anybody else who's ever up here preaching. I'll guarantee you, they'll all tell you the same thing. Nothing. Because as moment that happens, you're missed it. Because it's all about serving people. It's all about loving people. It's all about laying your life down for people. It isn't about gaining more for me. I need better network. I need a bigger book contract. I need a whatever. I need to be known. I need to be heard. I need to be seen. I need to be understood. None of that. As soon as that enters into it, it's a little leaven. The whole thing gets leavened. Forgive me. So I want you to understand that. He that desires to be a teacher, take heed. There's greater condemnation. Because as they talk about in here, when you begin to teach the Word of God, you begin to preach the Word of God, you have people you can lead them astray. You can teach them they need to be circumcised. And because you speak so well or whatever, they might believe you. And then you bring them into a place of bondage. It's a fearful thing. I can tell you that all this week, Pastor Mark told me, I want you to minister. That's the first thing that I always do. Every time he ever says to me, the first thing I always do, oh, Lord, Lord, please help me. I don't want to do anything wrong. I don't want to take one wrong step. I don't want to say one wrong thing. I just don't. Please help me. I'm just crying out to God because I need you, Lord. You got to keep me because everything's got to be right. It's got to be the way you want it to be. That's how we need to be in every day of our life. Not fearful, just submitted. Not afraid of doing wrong, but just recognize the only way to do right is to yield to the Holy Ghost. I just know that. How do I yield to the Holy Ghost? I ask. Simple. So I'm not walking around, I don't want you to get the wrong idea. You're not walking around in fear. Oh, I'm so afraid I might say the wrong thing and then the lightning bolt will come from heaven and kill me. I'm not walking around in fear. I'm just saying I acknowledge, Lord, that it's got to be you. I acknowledge, Lord, that it's got to be love. I acknowledge, Lord, that you have set me upon your heart because you love me. But you've also set every one of these upon your heart because you love them. So, Lord, love them through me. Love them. Strengthen them. Impart to them whatever it is that they need. The strength, the wisdom, the knowledge. But more than anything else, the desire to walk in the Spirit. Lord, this is what we want. So here we are. We can't do this. I can't do this of myself. I can't. There's nothing I can do. But I can ask God, and he can minister. So, Father, in Jesus' name, now, Lord, I pray, I earnestly cry out to you, Lord, that every single one here, every single one, Father, I ask you to touch them by your Spirit deep inside, Lord, and bring them to a place of trusting in you like they've never trusted in you before. Lord, in Jesus' name, we set everyone free, whatever bondage there may be, whatever lie has held them back, whatever hindrance has been in their way, whatever sin they've not seen, whatever lying false word has kept them in a place where they cannot walk with you, Lord, to know how much you love them, each and every one, and you have called them to walk in the Spirit and not to fulfill the lust of the flesh. Lord, every single one here set free to worship you, set free to praise you, set free to give thanks, set free, O Lord God, to minister by love, serving one another in a way deeper than they've ever known before. Father, that we in this place would be known by our love, that we would be known as those people that just love people. We love people. We don't hold things against them. We don't separate ourselves from them in the sense of hurting them or telling them they're inferior or pushing them away, but we love them. We love them. And we keep ourselves unspotted from the world. We keep ourselves walking in the Spirit. And then we reach out in the Spirit to love. Father, this life in the flesh, we now live by the faith of the Son of God, by the Spirit. We wait for that day of the resurrection of the body. We wait for that day when there's going to come an end and the wrath that you have towards sin is going to be manifested in all its fullness. And we press towards that day, looking for that day, ready for that day. But while we wait and while we look, we love people around us, even those that we might save as if by fire, those people that we pull right up out of hell, that we bring them into a place of receiving from you. Lord, that out of this love to serve one another comes a love for the lost, a love and a desire to see people set free from the bondage of sin, broken free, Lord God, from the darkness of this world. Lord, that they might know that we have the things of God flowing out from us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, I thank you for great humility in your people. Great humility to be corrected. Great humility to be taught. Great humility to rely upon you and not upon themselves. Great humility not to judge by natural things ever again, but Lord, to judge by the Spirit, which is to serve one another in love. In Jesus' name. Now, if there's anybody has any need, I can feel healing. We can see your need met. If you got any need, whatever it may be, first of all, I'm going to ask, if there's anybody here who does not know Jesus, has not called upon the name of the Lord, does not know you're born again, does not know your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, is not certain that if you died tonight, you go to heaven, I want you to come up here. I want you to get off your blessed assurance and come up here so that we might see you come into the kingdom. I don't actually believe there's anybody like that, but I just in case. But if there's any other need, whatever it might be, if there's something you've harbored in your heart, if there's something you need to get rid of, if there's a bondage needs to be broken, but especially if there's some kind of sickness or disease, we're going to pray for you. We want you to come up to the front. We'll pray for you. Those of you that aren't coming up to the front, you can come. You can come. You don't have to stop. Those of you that aren't, I want you to pray. Keep in mind the things of the Spirit, what God's doing. Pray. Please, earnestly pray. Seek after God. Say, Lord, what do you want to do with me? What's going on with me? And pray for those people that have a need. And if you've got tithes or offerings to give, you can worship the Lord with them. Respectfully worship the Lord. Bring your tithes and your offerings. Don't ever fail to do that. It's very, very important that you do it. Why? Because God wants to bless you. And it's an acknowledgement that you put your trust in Him and not in yourself. You're saying, Lord, I'm going to do it your way because I put my trust in you. That's simple. I've been doing that for a long time. I've been blessed. God has blessed me. But we started early on giving tithe, giving offerings. We didn't stop. This you need to keep doing. Keep on doing. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, for your people.